In today's debt lesson, we're going to look at who are the stakeholders in a typical business. Basically, every business has a number of stakeholders, and they're loosely defined as people who have vested interests in the success of the business. These include the owners and the shareholders of the business, people who actually have a financial stake in the business, people who can expect or are we expecting profits to be returned to them. That includes the managers and employees. Basically, they have a vested interest in the business continuing so they can maintain their employment. Many managers and employers also become shareholders of the business and can be part of the ownership structure of it as well. We also have customers of the business and suppliers, and also wider society. So if the business is involved in providing services to the community, like healthcare, the wider society has a vested interest in the business, stakeholders, and they all have an interest in it continuing. The business is a responsibility of the shareholders. Basically, they're aiming to make profit. You buy shares in a company aiming to receive some of that profit in dividend as well as capital growth in the shares. The business's number one priority is to increase profits. You need to maximise profit and return those profits as dividends to shareholders. Business is responsible for communicating to shareholders. Keep the shareholders informed on how the business is tracking. They basically typically do this every year at an annual general meeting, reports on their performance and how they measure up against targets. They provide a forum for the shareholders to express their views at these annual general meetings. Every shareholder gets to vote on the future direction of the business. You typically get one vote per share. Small shareholders obviously don't have much of a say in the business compared to say corporate entities that may own millions of shares in the business. Businesses have a number of responsibilities to the managers of the business that we report it to them. These include to support the managers, required to basically provide decisions that the managers make on their behalf, and basically to give the grant the managers authority to actually make decisions. They're also required to provide corporate policies to assist the managers in making decisions. It makes it much easier to make a decision on the direction of the business or disciplining staff if there are policies to allow you to cover the incident. A good business will give development opportunities to managers, provide appropriate training on how to do the job or how to do their job better and how to improve, and provide a career path. This means that there's an opportunity for you to expand or develop or go up into more senior levels of management. Businesses have a number of responsibilities to employees. They're required by law to provide a safe working place. A workplace free from bullying, harassment and discrimination of any sort, and a safe working environment. So you're not going to be at risk, or at minimal, you're only going to be at minimal risk of any workplace accidents. Required, a good business will provide fulfillment opportunities to the employees, an opportunity to achieve and advance within the business, often under promotion to management, and a work-life balance, which means that your work is not going to take precedence over your home life. You're not going to be required to come in on weekends or at the drop of a hat on a regular basis. So you're able to run out, you know, so you're going to impact on the employees' families. Business has a number of responsibilities to its consumers. Aiming to provide satisfaction for your customers. Dissatisfied customers tend to tell everybody else that they're dissatisfied. And word of mouth can have a very detrimental effect on the business. Your products and services by law must be fit for purpose. That means they must do what you advertise that they will do, and they must actually do the job. So for example, a computer must be able to run the type of software that you say it will, or connect the type of networks that you will do. There is one exception in Australian law to the fit for purpose requirement, and that's actually provision of software. Because without fail, all software contains bugs. If software had to be warrantied as fit for purpose, we wouldn't be able to sue the software companies for refunds. They don't warranty that it's fit for purpose. They warranty specifically that it's not fit for purpose, but they will endeavour to fix any problems. Disputes regarding whether or not a product is fit for purpose or not must be solved in a fair and equitable manner. There are a number of organisations in Australia that allow consumers to take complaints regarding the products or the services they receive from the business. Business is responsible to be fair to its consumers. Advertising and marketing must not be misleading, must not contain factually incorrect information. And businesses are responsible for providing a fair market, like you're not trying to fix prices to take advantage of any control they have over the market. The Australian Competition and Consumers Commission takes a very dim view of any companies attempting to fix prices.